Our week-long cartoonist tribute continues as we now return to Modern Masters, the Charles Schulz story. After the untimely death of the still-active Schulz in 2000, fans across the world mourned his passing. Many thought they had seen the last of the Peanuts gang. But had the final chapter yet been written? The answer tonight as we conclude the Charles Schulz story.
Well, after he died, there was definitely a difficult grieving period. Not only for me, but I think, you know, for everyone.
But after the somber period of acceptance, Billy Schulz made an inspired decision.
Peanuts did not have to end because Charles did. And I vowed I would continue the strip.
Despite no formal art training, Billy let nothing deter him from forging ahead.
I'm an electrical engineer by trade, so when I first started drawing the strip, I wasn't sure I could fill such big shoes. But as it turns out, everything is okay. My fourth grade teacher said she couldn't believe I was the son of such a brilliant man.
But was he even the son of Charles Schulz? Some disagreed.
So what if you never let me call him Dad? I'm the inspiration for Rerun, you know.
Blood relation aside, Billy always had a fondness for Charles and his cartoon strip, Peanuts.
Well, we didn't spend much time together. Peanuts ran every day for almost 40 years, so he spent every waking moment drawing. Well, that and the drinking. Drinking and drawing. 4:30 in the morning, I'm trying to sleep. Dad comes barging in, big bottle of whiskey in his hand, half drunk already, and he just starts shaking me in bed and waking me up and going on and on, but I don't even know what. All I heard was, wah, 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 wah.
It was witnessing that devotion that led Billy to want to bring Peanuts back to life.
You know, I'm finally getting a chance to know these characters a little bit better now, and I think my artistic style is finally catching up with my ideas, and of course, thank God for tracing paper. When I was a little kid, I would always run up to Charles and try to bounce off my little Peanuts plot ideas. Of course, none of them ever really got through because he had the door locked and I was on the other side.
Despite his affection for Snoopy and the gang, Billy Schulz wanted to ensure that the legacy wouldn't get stale.
And let me tell you something, drawing a comic every single day, woo, it gets pretty tired after a while. Jesus Christ, you know. You can slowly slide down the ramp to sub-Marmaduke level in like no time flat. So before I lose my monkey completely, I have to go out, I have to get inspired. I go to the source. A premise, a character, something. Come on, give me something. You're not giving me anything, okay? You're a fraud, you know that? You're supposed to be creative, you're a kid. Kids are creative. You're just sitting there. What kind of kid are you? I'm up against a creative wall here, okay? Is there a creative kid here? One with so much energy they share it? Let go!
No!
Let go!
No!
Hey! You! Hey! Oh! Stop!
It's in my nose!
Ah!
I'm trying to make the characters more realistic, you know?
Oh, God.
And as a kid, I used a lot of f***ing profanity. And I think we'd move more product if we knew what Woodstock was actually saying.
What Billy hadn't thought about, however, was a possible backlash.
Some of my early work wasn't as PC as Dad. You know, I think my core readers truly understand and appreciate what I'm trying to do. And then there are just some people, they refuse to change. Oh yeah, and I got rid of that Snoopy character.
And with the disappearance of characters came the disappearance of fans. But Billy Schulz persevered.
Some people don't like my father. Some people don't like me. But I'll tell you something. Funny pages aren't about making people happy. I'm trying to make little kids think. I want to take off the top of their head and spank their naughty brains. Yeah, you in the cool sweater.
Where's Snoopy? Where'd he go?
Well, Snoopy got hit by a car. I'm sorry. He was alive, but he was all busted up. Yeah, we had to put him down.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah, here's the proof. It was an artistic choice.
Still, some readers did take to the revitalized Peanuts strip.
Oh man, that Billy is one funny dude. Them new Snoopies he's been writing? Right here, just bust my belly. And I'm not easy to amuse. That is funny! Coffee.
However, not everyone found the new strip as funny.
Universal Press Syndicate tried to drop our strip. And believe me, I'm not the kind of guy who casually throws around the phrase suckers. Oh yeah, we got the strip out on our own.
Three peanuts! Three peanuts! Three. It's free! Free f***ing peanuts! 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 I had it. Come on, man.
And you're a comic artist. You influence people. And when you influence people, you're gonna make a lot of enemies.
It's nice to get out. You know, being a comic artist, you're stuck in the study, long hours, just drawing and thinking and plotting. So, it's all frustrating, you know? So it's good to get out. How much are these two items?
$8.75 and $1.99.
Okay, I'm no good with math. What is that all together?
$10.75.
Oh, that's a little steep. Yeah. So,
tell you what.
Tell you what? Stay right there. No, don't move. Don't move. Okay, hang on. Just like that. Yeah, no. Hold that confused look. What you're gonna have is gonna be worth a lot more than money. Are now the proud owner of an original Schultz.
So, Mom didn't want to have to keep paying for my rent and for my limos. Anyway, Universal Press calls, and they pick up the strip again. We're back in action. The checks come slamming in, and just in time. Yeah, well, I'm thinking that children are this fountain of, you know, creativity and light, and this one is just standing there, staring at Yahold. You know, people think defending against assault charges are cheap. I beg to differ. Not when it involves children. Then it gets real complicated. Yahold, hi. Well, here's what you tell them. Tell them, whiplash, schmiplash, some kids deserve to be shaken.
For Billy, continuing the Peanuts tradition wasn't about money. It was about something more, something almost spiritual.
Do I think that my father's looking down at me from heaven, watching on proudly as I continue his legacy? Probably not. Now, I bet you he's up there inventing brand new round-headed kids to pay attention to. Oh, and drinking. Definitely drinking. Woo! I'm tripolar.
In the end, one thing is for sure. The memory of Charles Schultz will live on for quite some time. Next week, Modern Masters continues its cartoonist tribute with Garfield's Jim Davis.
Oh, when he was young, he killed cat after cat. I'd tell young Jimmy not to feed him lasagna, but he wouldn't listen.
Next week on Modern Masters.
Good grief.
Okay, can you introduce yourself to our audience?
Please welcome the comedy stylings of Rick Overton.
And the demure introduction of Joe Lewis.
Okay. And Joe, you have a film in the Mockfest, right?
Yeah, I have a short film that we did called Billy Schultz. It's a mockumentary about the illegitimate son of Peanuts creator Charles Schultz.
Well, did you have the permission of Charles Schultz?
We had no express permission of the Schultz and Schultz estate, but we are big fans of the Schultzes and the Schultz estate. And okay. I am located outside of the country, so nothing can happen to me legally.
Where are you located?
Santa Monica, I believe that's its own incorporated area. No? Yeah. Did I read that?
Okay. After the next major earthquake, it'll actually be literally separated from the country. So. Yeah.
Okay. Well, first, tell us how you got into the business. You're a filmmaker.
I am a filmmaker. I got into the business. I went to film school at USC, and this sketch started as part of a Saturday Night Live audition packet, and this seemed to stand alone, and I was introduced to Rick, who made it actually stand alone and got lucky enough to make it with him. And he made it about 1,000 times better than that original script was.
Oh, it was a great script. It was very funny.
Well, when did you graduate from SC?
I graduated in 2000.
Now, how did you get into the business?
Joe approached me and asked me to be in and showed me the script. I laughed my ass off and I said, I'm there. So
business predated this script by far. This was I would call it the low point of Rick's career. Was shooting this film. He has a storied Emmy-winning career.
No, I can tell with that voice. Now, how did you start acting?
I always liked comedy, and I always liked acting. Mm-hmm. And sort of side by side, I was doing both simultaneously, and this would be my 40th year.
Wow. Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, what was your big break?
This film, right here. It was my biggest break, and that's why you're going to get a chance to see it tonight.
Okay, great. I can tell with you in it, it's great.
that's a good sign when you can tell right here how good it is. It's a really funny, clever idea, and he shot it so straight, so legitimate. That's the secret to good mockumentary is you give – it's not everything is a joke. Wait, do a normal thing, bang, weird thing, more normal, music exactly like the music, graphics perfectly matched to the graphics on biography, and the more perfect you make everything else, the better each joke will pop out, and that's one of the great secrets, and he has it down perfect, great filmmaker, and we both are huge fans of Stanley Kubrick.
I also think it's important to note that everything he just named was done by someone else, and it's about getting those smart people together who are better than me at doing every single one of those things, and that includes the person who is the front of the entire thing, which is Rick. And without him, I mean, there's absolutely no way it would be anything close to what it is now, if it is anything now.
He's a great director. I'd love to be in whatever he makes next.
I would like to make something next.
That's the plan.
That is my goal.
Yeah.
Okay. And what's the name of your film?
The name of my film is Billy Schultz.
Billy Schultz. Okay, and how long is it?
It is about 10 minutes long.
Okay, and where can we find it on the web?
You can search a website called YouTube. It's at youtube.com. You can search Billy Schultz. I recommend watching it.
Okay, now...
ask me about the budget.
Okay, what about the budget?
Shot it for peanuts. Come on, for crying out loud. It's right there. It's right in front of you.
No. Okay, now tell me about your role in it.
This guy's an idiot. He's a loser, and he thinks he's all that, and he thinks he can compete with Charles Schultz, and he's a hack, and he takes himself very pompously and seriously, mm-hmm. But he's a total knucklehead, you know, which is the fun, that's the golden fun of it,
is
okay, so you're made fun of
secret autobiographical film. I just found out it was a comedy from you right now. This is awkward for me. I wasn't aware he was pompous. So when you're watching this, bear that in mind. It was made sincerely.
Yeah. That's if you guys are thinking about making a mockumentary. It's not how smart you are. It's not how cool you are. It's not how funny you are. It's how smart, cool, and funny you think you are, but you were utterly blowing it unapologetically, and you just march ahead without ever turning back. No diversion. Just keep screwing it up and being sweet and or whatever you want to be about it. Just stick with it. It's not like normal acting in the sense that it's the opposite in many ways. When in conventional film scripted acting, you're supposed to have a second agenda and another voice going on and an animal and all that. None of that. Very linear and direct, and you can't have any idea what you're looking like, what you look like on the documentary camera, and you blow it. That's like the best work of the Christopher Guest films is all. You just don't say that aloud. Ugh, you said it, you know? That kind of thing.
I would argue it's the most daring, risk-taking type of work you can do. You put yourself out there, and inherently anything creative is a risk, and if you're doing the thing that's the end of the largest end of the spectrum, I feel like that's the most creative endeavor you can possibly make. And
yeah,
in some way, it's the perfect mix of drama and comedy.
And you got to look like an idiot. It doesn't work if you're really smart. That mockumentary falls apart if you're really good at what you do. You got to be bad and think you're good.
Yes. Documentaries are great for idiots, and mockumentaries are great for people who are smart enough to not be...
To play the idiot.
We need to edit that part about my idiotic statement about idiots out. I feel like the universe just collapsed.
Well, does the audience wish... Okay. Does the audience wish that something would happen to his character in your film?
I think the audience assumes something will happen either right after the cameras go off or shortly thereafter.
Car crash or or emotional breakdown.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. You guys are bonehead.
I can't wait to see it.
Good. If you've heard of bipolar, he's the first tripolar character on film.
I'm either really happy, really sad, or somewhere in between.
Okay, now, was this film improv, or did you have a script that he just added to?
We had an outline of a script that we improvised around. We had scenes beaded out, and we worked through it sometimes with many, many, many takes, and we got to the right thing, and everyone was different, and everyone was great, and that makes the process of editing it harder, and that might be why it's hard to whittle it down to something great, and hopefully we've gotten it down.
Your cut's great. It's a great cut.
Oh, great. And since you've been in the business for 40 years, can you tell us what else you've done?
Well, did you see Bad Teacher? I'm the uncle and bad teacher.
I'll speak for him. Rick has a brilliant HBO special that you should see. Rick was the head writer on the Dennis Miller Show, for which he won an Emmy, and then he's a performer in such movies as...
Groundhog Day, Mrs. Doubtfire, Year One... I'm like a character actor, so I'm, you know, it's like whack-a-mole. I'm, there he is. Oh, there he goes. There's Rick. Here's Rick. And there's lots of those added up. I've been over 100 films.
I think of him as the voice of America.
I'm neck and neck with Ron Jeremy for the amount of films I've been in. And I literally neck and neck.
Okay.
No small parts, only small actors.
No, I mean, how tall are you?
6'4", I'm 6'4", but what can I say?
So, I mean, so we can't know. I mean, I know I've seen you in tons of things. You're so humble. I mean, I gave you this chance to promote everything you've done, and he promoted you.
Right.
You're wonderful.
You saved me there, brother. You saved me, Joe.
I'm a hype man at best.
It's great.
In my best days.
Well, I can't wait to see this film. Thank you so much for this interview. You've made it wonderful.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It was a joy talking with you.
Okay. And can you say hello to our morehorror.com fans? Even though you made a mockumentary, I know that you'll make a horror film in the future, right?
Well, I made a mockumentary, and the only wish I had about it that there was more horror, which is, makes it easy to remember that you should watch more horror.
Great.
Hi, this is Rick Overton, and you're watching MoreHorror.com.